next, Shimdi. I have been doing the Total Money Makeover for the last few years of my life, taking it kind of seriously. When I started doing it, the main thing I wanted to do was to get rid of my student loan debt. I had tens of thousands in debt. I made a video about, you know, how I got rid of it using the Total Money Makeover. I'm actually on baby step number 4 of the book. Step number 1 is to, of course, build your emergency fund. Step number 2 is to pay off all your debt. Step number 3 is to then build your emergency fund to be 3 to 6 months of your living expenses, depending on how, you know, kind of volatile your life is. And then step number 4 is to start investing. So I'm gonna cover 3 things in this video. 1, I'm gonna talk about how much money I make. I think it's really important to be transparent about this. Keeping secrets about your wages is how employers take advantage of you. But most importantly, it's because it helps you make an informed financial decision. There's so much advice around how you should spend and save and invest your money, but it can be really hard to know what's right for you if you don't know how much folks are actually making and how that actually makes sense within their lifestyle. And without that, you don't know if it makes sense to apply it to your own. The other reason is because I think we have really unhealthy relationships to money. We tie salary directly to someone's self-worth. And I think it's really important to remember that money is just the result of, like, oh, I chose to work at a nonprofit instead of going into finance. I chose to live in DC and LA instead of living in the Midwest. It's all made up, you know, it doesn't really mean anything. And the other reason I really want to share how much money I make too is because I was actually watching a YouTuber on here. Her name is Kelly Stamps. I found her videos to be really motivational because she's super transparent about how much money she makes on YouTube. And as someone who's also a Black girl trying to be successful on YouTube, it's really helpful to see someone else and know, okay, if I reach this level, I can be expecting to make about this amount of money. The other thing I'm gonna talk about is how much money I've saved. The Total Money Makeover talks about saving 3 to 6 months of your salary. Closer to 3 if you're pretty comfortable, and then 6 months is if you have some more of that instability. Maybe you work freelance. I have a salary role, have general stability in my life, don't have independence, don't have any kids, you know, I'm just kind of like out here. I think it could be like a helpful reference point for you. And then third, and most importantly, I'm gonna talk about how I got started investing. I knew it was something I should be doing, but I wasn't ever pulled to do it. I just fundamentally didn't really understand why I should be investing instead of just saving. I just wanna talk about kind of what got me to the point where I was able to start investing and how you hopefully can too, if what I'm saying makes sense to you. So that is the video. Woo, we're gonna get into a lot of stuff in this video. Go ahead and give this video a thumbs up before we get started. Subscribe if you haven't already. Come on, join the family. And then drop a comment below. Do you currently invest? If you don't, what stopped you? Okay, let's go ahead and get into it. Let's start with salary. How much money do I make at my job? For context, I work at a nonprofit. I've worked at nonprofits for 8 years. I'm at the director level. My nonprofit was based in DC and I have since moved to Los Angeles. And our salary is informed by COLA, so cost of living that's set by the government. And it adjusts your salary based on where you live. So given all of that, I make $81,000 a year as a director at my education nonprofit. I think that's fine. I read a study a while ago that showed that around 75K is essentially how much money you need to be making to be happy, basically, in terms of covering your general expenses in life. And so for me, as soon as I hit 81, I've very much been like, okay, this is fine. For context, I have a master's degree and I started my career as like an intern and then I was hired full time. I talk about this a little bit in my how to effectively work from home video.
As an associate at around 42.5. When I was a manager at that same role, I was making around 60. A lateral move to maybe like 58, 59. And then I think my next jump, maybe around 67, until I got the promotion to director at the top of 2020 and began making 81.
I hope that's helpful. Before making this video, I myself was like,
I wanna tell them how much money I make.
For a couple of reasons. One, I saw a stat that said only about like 41% of Americans would be able to afford a $1,000 emergency expense. And so I feel very, very privileged to be making as much as I'm making, especially as a single woman with no kids and no like major health issues. I'm very, very, very blessed. And at the same time, I live in our capitalist society. So I feel like, oh, I should be making 6 figures. I should be balling out. And so I was like, do I even want to tell people? I was like, am I making too much money? People are going to be like, let me find where she lives and rob her. Or they're going to be like, why should I even like listen to her and take her advice when she's only making 81? All I can do is just tell you the truth. And then you can decide if it's still worth engaging with my content. Let's talk about savings. So I currently have $10,000 saved. This is basically the most amount of money I have ever had saved in my entire life. One thing I really want to emphasize is how much this is not a reflection of my personal choices. Well, it is and it isn't.
Within the world of finance and investing and total money makeover and FIRE movements, there's this huge emphasis on personal responsibility and about like working hard and you just like save up enough money and that's what allows you to blah, blah, blah. Basically what all these philosophies are saying is that if you are poor, it is your own fault. We all know that is not true. We all know there are systemic inequalities stories that keep people in poverty, that it is more expensive to be poor than to be rich. We know the way generational wealth works. We know the way investment income works. If you have a family that is wealthy, you are going to be wealthy. And if you are poor, it is very, very, very hard to pull yourself up out of poverty. And if you do, chances are you had a lot of people helping you. And I think it's important, if you want to make that amount of money, then you recognize that you need to essentially like work with the system to make that kind of money. It is not about pinching pennies and saving on Starbucks and all this other stuff. Like, that is a scam.
So how was I able to save up this amount of money? There were three important things. The first was my salary increase. I started getting paid more money at my full-time job, and then I was able to save up more money. It wasn't because I stopped going to Starbucks or I stopped eating out or all this other stuff. Nope. The second thing was taking advantage of our tax system. So when I participated in Remote Year, which is a program where you spend a year living out of the country, I was able to take advantage of a tax law or rule where essentially if you spend more than a year living outside of America, they will refund you your federal income taxes because you spent that entire year not living in America. So first was getting the increase in salary, two was getting that federal refund, and third was getting the stimulus money from COVID. So with those things combined, that's how I was able to save those $10,000. And then for context, I don't have a car, so I don't pay car payments, insurance, any of that stuff. So really my biggest major expense is my rent. My actual rent is around $1,450, but with like utilities and things included, ends up being about $1,550 a month. And so for me, about $10,000, it's not up to 6 months, but it's definitely more than three. And given that I am generally stable in my life, that kind of meets the criteria for me.
Hey y'all, it's Chimney from the thumbnail with my $1 bill. I truly don't have any other physical money. This was it, okay? Go ahead and give this video a thumbs up if you haven't already. I appreciate you, okay? All right, back to the video.
So that's how much money I have saved. And next, let's talk about investing. So I only started investing this year, and it truly is due to a single friend of mine, my girl Brie. So she said again and again, girl, check out some of these YouTubers. She was like, I learned everything I know from YouTube. So she recommended two channels, Investing with Rose, and she recommended Our Rich Journey. And so I was like, all right, let me go ahead and do my little investigating. Y'all, it was a game changer. For me, the fundamental thing that I learned from those channels that really allowed me to take the leap to actually start investing was when I learned that saving alone is actually losing money. I was like,
if I just have money, if I just have savings, if I just have cash, that's just as good.
No, it's not. And you're like, how could it not be? Because of inflation. Essentially, it's the way kids in the olden days could use 10 cents and buy a whole house or whatever, because the money was worth more then. Our money now is gonna be worth less in the future. And just in the time I've been alive, the cost of the US dollar has been cut in half. So the things that I would have bought then with my money, if I had any money as a baby, I would need twice as much to get the same thing now. So by just saving and not investing, you're actually losing money. That was kind of the biggest game changer for me, was that like, oh wow, I thought I was doing something good for myself by just saving. But in reality, if you invest in the stock market over time, you see rates of like 7 to 10%, versus if you just have, even if a high yield savings account where you're making like 1 to 2%, that's still less than the inflation rate, which I think is around 3%, you are losing money. And as soon as I knew that, I was like, okay, well then I'm not dumb. Let me figure out what I have to do to invest. The book I'd recommend, if you're like, I don't know anything about investing, I just want to figure out how it works, is The Little Blue Book That Beats the Market. It's one of the books that was recommended by Investing with Rose, and essentially just breaks down what investing is. In the simplest terms, when you buy a stock, you're buying part of a company. So if the company is a good company, if it actually is making things that are helpful, if it's actually well run, as that company continues to do its thing and to make money, you are getting a piece of that increased value of that company. So the way I think of the stock market is, you have these companies that genuinely create services, right? Like Apple makes laptops. They're making a thing we actually want and need, but we know money itself is made up. So the actual value of that thing fluctuates depending on how people are feeling. So when there's a major natural disaster, for instance, like when there's like a 9/11, people get scared because they're humans, as we all are. And so they pull their money out of the stock market because they just are like, I really want to have my money. And so the value of these companies goes down, even though the actual value of how much they're creating and how much people want that product and how well run the company is doesn't actually change at all. And then when people kind of come back to their senses and they calm down, the value then goes up again. And the same way, sometimes we get really optimistic, you know, things are going super great. You know, maybe there's like an election, we like the person who was elected, all this kinds of stuff, and then prices will go up. More people are coming into the market because they think things are so great. And then of course, the market stabilizes and things go back down and then you lose money. So essentially the point of the stock market market is to buy very good companies when they are cheap because people are probably scared or something, and then just kind of watch your money grow and grow because the companies themselves are valuable. I think there are three main things that decide the type of investing that you do. One is your goal. So do you want to make a lot of money, or do you just want to set yourself up for a good retirement? Two, do you have the time to research individual companies and really do the work to figure out, you know, where you should be investing and how and what investment strategy you want to take? And three, how risk averse are you? Are you okay to kind of ride the waves of the stock market because fundamentally you understand that over time it is going to go up? Or are you more concerned about just kind of holding on to your money and you don't have the emotional bandwidth to deal with these kind of highs and lows? So for me, one, I do not care about being filthy rich. I'm a woman of faith. I'm a Christian. I love me some Jesus. Can we talk about how we've waited until this moment in the video to talk about Jesus? Impressive, right? It's so important to me that nothing distracts from my ultimate God, which is God. When you care about money, I think it can be very easy to make money your God. And all you care about is making money and spending money and how much money people make. And I'm just like, to me, I'm like, there's literally nothing less interesting. Life is about friendship, community, love, joy, growth, and you know, anyway, separate spiritual conversation. Point is, for me, wealth was not the major thing. The main thing for me was just kind of having a comfortable setup for retirement. The second thing is how much time you have to do all the research on investing. Because I don't care about money, I am not going to spend my Saturdays and Sundays researching stocks and researching board reports and corporate statements so I can make sure I'm making smart financial decisions. If that's what you want to do, that's fine. Personally, I would truly rather spend that time watching a Netflix show, hanging out with a friend, going outside, taking a nap. And the third thing is risk aversion. So I live a pretty low risk life. It may not seem like it from the outside looking in, where you see me like gallivanting to all these foreign countries. If we had a real conversation, you would understand why. I truly do not believe I've taken any genuine risk in my entire life. I'm gonna start changing that. Now that I'm 30, I'm realizing how much of life is supposed to be lived and supposed to be spent doing things that are a little crazy and a little reckless and a little wild. As COVID has taught us too, we truly only have this one life and we do not know when it's gonna end. In terms of my financial life, I am still pretty risk averse and that has not changed. So given all of that, let's talk about the specifics of how I invest. I invest with Charles Schwab as my broker. A broker is literally just the platform you use to buy and sell stocks. Honestly, I think opening a brokerage account with Fidelity, which is the one that's super popular, Charles Schwab, which is the one I use because literally I just already used it. And then Vanguard is the other really popular one because it's just been around forever. Honestly, I think if you're someone who wants to start investing and you haven't yet, the first thing you should do is just open up an account. And if you don't take that step, then you're not serious about this. You need to stop lying to yourself. The next step, put money in that account. This is so important because you can only be invested when you are invested. You have to put some of your skin in the game. And then for me, the approach I take is I invest with index funds. Index funds, for instance, the S&P 500, Standard & Poor's 500. Don't know who Standard or Poor is, but 500 is just the 500 biggest companies. So essentially you're just like buying into the stock market, which includes some of the biggest companies that are doing really great, as well as the companies that like are hot and are flashing in the pan that actually might end up going bust. And because you're not being really surgical and getting just those super high quality companies, you're also getting the trash ones as well. The overall returns are not going to be as high as if you like truly focused in. And for me, I'm fine with that because that's compared to 0.5%, you know, that my savings account is doing. I'm fine with making 10% by doing literally nothing. So literally all of my money is in the SWPPX, which is the fund that tracks the S&P 500 for Charles Schwab. And then at one point I just randomly decided to buy some Apple stock. So once you have your brokerage account and you've moved your money in and you've chosen how you're going to invest, the fourth thing is to set up automatic payments. We live in a world. There are pandemics, market crashes, elections, natural disasters. There are all these things that happen. But if you look back, including the Great Depression, including 9/11, and all these major things that have happened, the stock market, man, it just keeps doing its thing. This is my advice, because this is what I do. Not even worry about these ups and downs. Just invest the same amount every month and let it do its thing. I also reinvest my dividends because I'm investing through my Roth IRA. So my point is retirement. It's not to just make money right now. So I just set up a reoccurring payment and every month I put $300 into this Roth IRA. $300 is not that much amount of money compared to what the Total Money Makeover says you should be investing. It says you should be investing 15% of your income. And the reason why I'm not is because I kind of cheated a little bit. The way the book is set up is that you're supposed to truly like finish one step before you do another. But as soon as I figured out the way investing worked, I just got super excited. And so I just started investing right away. And now I could start investing more. But I'm at a point in my life where I'm probably gonna leave LA once my lease ends. And I wanna have more money that's liquid. So I'm actually going to stop my investing and just put it on pause. It does feel a little risky to do that because I just know the way compound interest works. Like truly every dollar invested now means so much more than every dollar invested later. But that's just the nature of financial planning. You have all this advice and you have all these people who are telling you, here's how to do it, here's what I did, but only you know what actually makes sense for your life. And ultimately, no one is gonna live your life but you. I have just spent so much time talking. I'm like, rah, 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 rah. Did you make it to the end? That is impressive. Go ahead and give this video a thumbs up if it was helpful. Let me know below, like, where are you in your investment journey? Where are you in your savings journey? Subscribe if you haven't already. Everyone who already has, I love you so much. Thank you. And I'll see y'all in the next one. Bye.